Hello friends, welcome back to our next session, to our new session of JEE Advanced. So today we'll be covering our topic, atomic structure. This is quite an easy topic for us. I mean, we can easily theory. So with that, let us carry on with our questions, set of questions, right? Okay, guys. So coming to our first question here, as you can see, this question is probability based. This is a curve question. So this has graph involved in it. Let us see what is given to us in the question. We see that P is the probability of finding the 1s electron. What are you talking about? 1s electron of hydrogen atom in a spherical shell of infinitesimal thickness dr at a distance r from the nucleus. The volume of this shell is 4 pi r square dr. So let us understand first what they are talking in the question, right? So they are saying P is the probability of finding electrons in the 1s orbital. Now how they are doing it is, here they have taken, let's say this is our hydrogen atom, right? This is the nucleus. This part is the nucleus. And as you might have come across, we know that now we know that the electrons are not actually present in the orbits, but they are present inside the shells. And the shells, they are present in the orbitals, and they are located by different probability function, by different energies, right? So depending on that, electrons are basically not actually present in one place, but they give us a curve. It is a probability function, and the electrons are basically present as a cloud, right? We have learned that. So we know that there is a possibility of not finding electron in an orbit, but we can find it inside the shell anywhere, right? So electrons can be present from this nucleus. I'll change the color so that you can understand. So from this nucleus, all these regions, we can all color it, all these regions, we can take it as small as possible. All these regions can have electron. So that is what they are talking about, that the probability of finding it in the volume of the shell is 4 pi r square dr. So finding electron at any point here, or any place, any point, we can make similar concentric circles around the nucleus, and we can calculate the probability. Now what is asking of us is that if I'm talking about the 1s orbital of hydrogen atom, right? We know that the electrons in hydrogen atom are only one. We have only one electron in hydrogen atom. It could be present anywhere. Now, I am not saying that electron is a probabilistic curve. Electron is a particle, correct? But it is so fast in nature that we humans cannot actually capture it. Hence, what we do? We capture its motion, and we see that where the electron was present, and hence we come up with the probability curve, right? But electron is still a particle, although it's very fast, and hence it behaves as a wave. for us. Hence, we are taking out the probability curve. So, what it says is, if you find the probability out of these four graphs, which one represents the right probability of finding the electron, right? Okay. Now, let us see what our possibilities are. Now, here we can see there are four probabilities which is given to us, out of which these two cannot be the answers. If, why? Let us see why. Now, look at this. The probability of finding electron at radius is equals to 0, that is at nucleus, do you see this? The probability of finding electrons at nucleus cannot be more than 0, because electrons are never present inside the nucleus. They are present outside the nucleus. Hence, we can directly reject these two options, because they say that there is a finite probability of electrons lying inside the nucleus. No, it is not possible. Hence, these two answers are incorrect. I will tell you what these answers are about though. So, these are not probability functions, but they are radial wave functions. So, the radial wave function just tells us about that, it tells about the energy, right? It is a radial wave function. So, this radial wave function is about for 1s, and this radial wave function, as we can see, there is a node present here, right? So, this radial wave function tells us that there was a orbit here, and then there is a node, and there is another orbit, orbital, right? So, this is for 2s. Since the nodes are like this, since the graphs are like this, right? So, this is 2s and this is for 1s, because it has no node. This has no node. And this here, at this point, as you can see, at this point has one node. Since it has one node, that's why it is 2s, and this is 1s since it has no node. And but these two functions, these two curves are for radial curves, right? These are radial. Now, talking about these two here, now they both can be correct, but as you might have learnt in your theoretical classes, that the probability of finding an electron in a node is zero. That is not actually true. Theoretically, we consider it to be zero, but at any given point of time in a node, there is a 5% probability of finding the electron, just 5%, but there is still a probability. So, probability cannot be zero for finding an electron at any point of time, right? Hence, this graph is wrong. It cannot be exactly zero, okay? Hence, the answer is this. It's a simple way, it's a simply a very simple graph. I'll tell you how. So, we are talking about 1s. 1s has no nodes, right? At nucleus, there is no electron. Now, as we move forward here, what happens at this point? It has the maximum possibility. What is this point for hydrogen? This is the radius of hydrogen. This is A naught for hydrogen. This has the maximum possible maximum possibility of having the electron probability, and then it goes to again very less, approximately again 5%. So what is happening is, so if I talk about the hydrogen atom, here I have the hydrogen atom with one proton, okay, and now I have the electron present somewhere, let's say in this bound. So what we are saying is that probability of finding the probability of finding electrons here in this region is quite low. Then probability of finding electrons in this region increases. Then probability of finding electrons in this region is the most. Hence, the graph we see here at this point is 0, then at this point it starts increasing, again moving forward, so at the nucleus, it's 0, right, then it starts increasing, then it goes on increasing, where it comes to maximum, at maximum, after which the electrons again start falling, kyunki, why? This is because in this regions, the electrons will not be present, hence we get the graph for probability versus radius as this graph, alright. Now, let us move on to the next question. I hope you have understood the core concept lying behind this. Similarly, if I, this is for 1S, similarly if I talk about 2S, what kind of graph do I see? I see such a graph. So, electrons are present here, then there is a node, no electrons here. This graph actually looks more like, let us see again. So, here it goes, comes to a level and then goes and then comes down. So, here we have our first, here no node, it's a node, no electron, and then here we have second peak. This is 2s. I hope you have understood the concept and this is how it evolves. Let us move on to the next question in our class. Okay, here now the question is the correct set of 4 quantum numbers for the valence electrons of rubidium. Rubidium atom, and we are given what our atomic number is. So, this question is about electronic configuration, finding out what the electronic configuration is. Let us see how to solve this question. Now, we have rubidium here, right? We have rubidium. What we know about rubidium, that we have Z equals to 37. For Z equals to 37, okay. Now, we will write, we know the Abbau principle. For the Abbau principle, we know how to write the electronic configuration. Following the principles, what do we get? 1s, then 2s, then 2p, 3s, 2p, 3s, 3p, 4s, 3p, 4s, then 3d, 4p, 5s, 3d, 4p, 5s, 4d, 5p. 4D, 5P and so on. Let us see how many we are going to utilize and then we will remove the others. Alright. So, now we have 37. Now, out of 37, 2 can go in the S orbital. So, 1S, 2. The next 2 can go in the 2S, next 2S orbital, because S orbital can contain only 2 electrons because it has only 1 orbital. So, here also 2. Now, P orbital has 3 places. So, in P, it will, we have 6 electrons, correct? 6 here, similarly 2 again here, 6 again here and 2 again here. Let's see, let's add up how many do we get here, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. We have filled 20 electrons, we are still left with 17 electrons. Let's fill 17 electrons here. 3D, D has 5 orbitals, Hence, it will have, it can contain 10 electrons, because one orbital contains 2 electrons, 5 will contain 10. Now, we are left with 30, now we are left with 7. 7 out of 7, 4p will take 6 and 5s will take 1. So, the remaining ones here are not existing. Theek hai? Now, after reaching the electronic configuration, what it has asked us, that what is the electronic configuration of the valence shell. Now, as we can see here, this is the valence shell 5s1. What is the electronic configuration? What are the different quantum numbers which are related to this valenced electron, alright. So, let us find it out. Now, with 5s1, we can observe that n is equals to 5. Here, n equals to 5. Now, talking about L here, L comes from S. S is the first orbital, right? So, L will be 0. For S orbital, L is 0. Since L is 0, M will also be what? 0. Talking about this one electron. Now, this electron can be present as plus half or minus half. We don't have that kind of choice. That depends on the atoms. Since there is only one electron, it can be clockwise or counterclockwise. Depending on that, S could be either plus half or minus half. Correct? So, our answer actually could be 5, 0, 0, plus half or 5, 0, 0 and minus half. Now, if both the answers are given, then we have to choose both of them. And if one is given, then we'll choose the one of them. Let us see the answers now. The answers are 5, 0, 0 plus half, 5, 1, 0 plus half. 5, 1, 1 plus half and 5, 0, 1 plus half. This and this makes them all wrong answers. Hence, this is our correct answer. 5, 0, 0, plus half. Similarly, we can have the answer 5, 0, 0, minus half. In this way, we find out the different different quantum numbers present depending upon this equation, this number here. This 5 represents n, this s represents l. Due to this s, we get an m which is always 0 for s, and this 1 gives us s, the value of s. All right, moving on. Energy of an electron is given by this formula. Now, this formula, though it is given to us right now in this equation, we still need to have this formula by heart. Learn this, or at least the relationship E is proportional to Z square by N square. At least this relationship should be remembered, or at least, or at most, this formula has to be learned. So, these values can do not have to be learned. These values can be okay if you can remember these values, that are great. Otherwise, I don't think there are much questions which might use this kind of values, but you still have to understand this formula and the importance that it possesses. Theek hai? So, we know this formula now, they are given to us. What they are asking of us is wavelength of light required to excite an electron in an hydrogen atom from level n equals to 1 to n equals to 2 will be, okay. We need to find the wavelength. We are given the energy, alright. So, what we can do first is, so they want to excite from n equals to 1 to n equals to 2. correct? Okay. So, what we can do is, we can find the energy for 1 and then we can find the energy for 2. From that, we can find the difference. Now, that difference is the difference in energy. What we need is the wavelength. So, how do we move from energy to wavelength? We will see that during the question, solving the question, alright? So, let us solve the question first and let us find out at least what, how much energy is required. Until that time, you think what is the connection between energy and wavelength, okay? Let us solve the question here. What we have? E1. What we have here is E1 So E1 would be using the formula minus 2.178 into 10 to the power minus 18 joules into z square by n square. We will use the same formula we need for hydrogen. For hydrogen, z equals to 1. Z is 1, correct? And we know the values of n. So, we will just use this formula 2.178 into 10 to the power minus 18. Minus 2.178 into 10 to the power minus 18. Into z square will be 1 square by n square, E1, for E1, this is right, for E1 we will have n equals to 1, this is in joules. Similarly, we can find the value of E2 by simply calculating the same value twice and substituting the value of n as 2 and the answer gives us in joule. Next, what we will do is take a subtraction, right? Take a difference of E1 and E2. That is how we get the energy required for the electron to jump from 1 to 2. That the energy required. Now, here we have n equals to 1 and here we have n equals to 2. Now, to jump this electron from here to here, some kind of energy is required and that is the difference between E1 and E2 that we calculate by just taking the difference E1 minus E2, which will give us minus 2.178 into 10 to the power minus 18 times 1 by 1 minus 1 by 4. Correct? What I have done is just taking a suppression from E1 minus E2. Now, this gives us the value minus 2.178 into 10 raised to power minus 18 into 3 by 4. What is this? This is energy difference. Correct? But they have asked us the value of lambda, the wavelength. How do we calculate that? From here, if you could understand this, I am going to rub the first part. Right? Now we have the energy difference here. We don't need this. Okay. Now, we know delta E, we need to find wavelength. What is the direct relationship? We have the direct relationship as delta E is equals to hc by lambda, right? Now, the value of delta H, delta E, is it given to us? Yes, it is given to us. The value of hc, now this value is in joules. The value of H and C is also given to us. So what we'll do is simply put these values together and find the value of lambda. So lambda would be here, lambda would be h c by delta e, right? The value of h is 6.62 10 to the minus 34. Right, this is in joules second. Now value of C is 3 into 10 to the power 8 meters per second. And the value of delta E can be given as this. (2.178 × 10⁻¹⁸) into 3. I am shifting this 4 in the numerator. Now this value was in joules. Now this joules and this second gets cut off. All we have to do is now calculate the value of lambda. Since we have used this, I am taking this off too. Now simply if we calculate from these the value of lambda, 6.62 × 10⁻¹⁴, right? So there is 3 again into 3. This also goes. So 34 minus 18, 18, 34, 35, 36, 37. Let's see the order first. The order becomes 34, 44, and 16. The value of minus, yeah, now we can calculate the order. This will give us 10⁻¹⁴ + 18 + 8. How much is that? 10⁻⁻⁸ and now calculating these factors here, 2.178 can be approximately taken as 2 and we can divide this to give us 2 here. So that will be approximately 13, 6 to the 12, hana? So multiplying 6.62 by 2, it will be 1.3. It will be 13 × 10⁻¹⁸ meter, which will be approximately how much? 1.3 × 10⁻¹⁷. 3. Now, looking at our answers here, the closest one we have is A, which is 1.2 × 10⁻¹⁷. 7. why do we have that kind of difference here is because of the approximations. The approximations that we have taken, we have considered this as 2, correct, and hence divided by 4. But if we take the exact values, we'll get the answer exactly equal to what is given in the question. But always remember to approximate is the perfect idea. Why? Because as you can see, the values are quite different. Now, if you do the approximation, you can do the calculations quite fast. Now, this question has a mistake here, kindly note. This has to be minus 34, which if I use correctly, then only can I get the answer. Okay, moving on. The wavelength associated with a golf ball weighing 200 grams and moving at a speed of 5 meters per hour is of the order. Now, we have asked again what wavelength, but this time what we are given is the weight of the ball and the speed of the ball. Now, what is the formula that associates the wavelength with the mass, that is a particle nature and the wave nature together are talked about in de Broglie principle, right? So, the formula for de Broglie tells us that lambda wavelength is equals to h by p. What is p here? P is the momentum. What is h? H is the Planck's constant and lambda is the wavelength. We have seen the value of h, that is 6.6 into 10 to the power minus 34 joule seconds. Now, we know h is equals to 6.6 into 10 to the power minus 34 joule seconds. We have the value of m in kgs, which is grams, that is 200 grams. 200 grams, that is 0.2 kg. Correct? And we have the speed, velocity. The velocity here is given to as at 5 meters per hour. 5 meters per hour. Okay. What do we need to find? The wavelength in meters. We need to convert this hours into seconds also. So, simply putting the formula, lambda is equals to h by mv. Now, the value of h is 6.6 into 10 raised to power minus 34 upon the value of m is 0.2 kg. We just need to make sure that the units are in the right order. And this here, 5 meters per hour, we need to convert this into seconds. So, it becomes 5 meters per hour. This 1 hour has 60 minutes and 1 minute has 60 seconds. So, this becomes the velocity in meters per second. Hence, we do a division here. Now, this 16 to 60 can be shifted. This thing here, denominator can be shifted here, right? So, I will just shift that, remove it from here and shift it to numerator, correct? Now, if I solve this, what do I get? So, this becomes 0.1 in the denominator, okay? So, this 0.1 again goes up as 1 by 10, right? So, it becomes, so this value becomes 0.1, which is equals to 1 by 10. So, this 10 can also be shifted at the top. 6.6 into 10 to the power minus 34 into 60 into 60 into 10. So, 6.6 into 6 into 6, that is approximately 216. Again, as you can see, I am taking an approximation. How much? 216 into 10 raised to the power minus 31. If I put a decimal here, 2 more zeros will reduce. This will go to approximately. So if I take a if I take decimal here, this becomes 2.16 into 10 raised to power minus 29 meters, right? 10 raised to power minus 29. Now what they are asking is the order, right? For the order, the closest to this is 10 raised to power minus 30, right? The closest approximation to the lambda that we have received, the closest approximation to the lambda that we have received is of the order 10 to the power minus 30 raised to power minus 29, which is close to 10 raised to power minus 30 meters, right? We are asked exact, we are not asked the exact answer, but the order. What is the order? Just how many zeros does it have? Correct? Hence, we find this as our correct answer. Moving on, the correct ground state electronic configuration for chromium atom is, okay, chromium. For chromium here, we know that the electrons, now total number of electrons present are 24, correct? So, for chromium, the electronic configuration is 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, 4s2, 3d. How many have we here? 3d4. But chromium is an exception. Let us understand why. This should have been the answer actually, but it is not. Why? Because right now this d orbital this is 4s and this is 3d. Now, this d orbital contains 4 electrons, whereas this 4s contains 2 electrons. If by chance this 3d orbital would have one more electron, it will gain tremendous amount of stability. Why? By the virtue of it being half filled, it will become 3d5. So what happens is this 4s half filled and full filled, this is right now full filled. Even if it gives one more electron from here, it will still stay half filled, which is quite stable. But just by losing one electron and shifting it from here to here, what will happen? It will increase the overall stability of the atom, chromium atom. So what happens is this electron shifts from here to this place. In doing so, now the electron arrangement becomes this, which is 4s1 3d5. All right. And this here is the electron configuration for argon. So for us now, the correct configuration for chromium becomes, the configuration for argon the configuration for argon 4s1 and 3d5 4s1 3d5. Let us check. Here we have argon 4s1, 3d5. As you can see, so this is our correct answer. What's important to note here is that here we have 4s and here we have 3d, right? So these cannot be answer. Here they have used both are 4s. This cannot be answer, and both electrons cannot go into 3. This also cannot be answer. So this is our correct answer, as we have seen why. So this is quite important. This exam, this kind of exception also occurs in copper, where the d orbital becomes fully filled, and hence it gives quite more stability. Moving on, the ground state electronic configuration for nitrogen atom can be represented by, how do we represent that? So what do we have here? We have nitrogen. Nitrogen has 7 electrons present. These 7 electrons are present like this: 1s2, 2s2, 2p3. Correct? So as we can see here, 1s2, 2s2 are filled correctly. The question arises for 2p3. For 2p3, as we can see here, what do we know? That when the electrons go into the same kind of orbital, that is 3p, they will have same spin throughout. So by the virtue of that, these answers are wrong. So it can have any kind of spin, but it has to be same overall. So by the virtue of that, we can say that A and D are the correct answers. All right, moving on. Here we have a multiple type question. The hydrogen like species Li2 plus is in a spherical symmetric state S1 with one radial node. Upon absorbing light, the ion undergoes transition to a S2. The S2 state has one more radial node and its energy is equal to the ground state energy of hydrogen atom. Now they are asking us, what is the state S1 here? How can we calculate that? What do we know? We know that it is spherical in nature, correct? And one more thing that we know is that it is a radial node. So if you know the radial node, can we calculate total node out of from that? So one thing that we know is that it is either this answer or this answer. Why? Because it cannot be P. Now how do we know that how many, what is the N, what is the total number of nodes? That we can do by a simple formula, that we know that radial node is equals to N minus L, that is angular nodes, minus 1. We know that in the S1 state, the value of radial node is 1. Is there any angular node? No, there is no angular node. So the value of N becomes 1 plus 1, that is 2. So N becomes 2, and since we know already that it is an S orbital, the correct answer is this. Right? Moving on. Energy of the state S1 in units of hydrogen atom ground state energy. Okay. Let us see what is the hydrogen atom ground state energy first. So, hydrogen atom ground state energy would be K N square by Z square. This K is a constant. Now, for hydrogen atom, N is also equals to 1, Z is also equals to 1. So E becomes equals to K. But for S1, which is a 2s orbital, right? And it is for lithium. So for lithium, which is a 2s orbital, the value of N is 2. and the value of z, so the E is equals to k z square by n square and not the opposite. I have done it wrong, correct it, k z square by n square. Now by the virtue of hydrogen, z and n are 1, hence the E is equal to k. For lithium here, if I calculate for lithium ion, z is 3. Energy for lithium ion, z is 3, 3 ka square becomes 9 and n is 2, 2 ka square becomes 4. So, the answer is 4 divided by 9, 2.25, because it says in the terms of, in the units of hydrogen atom ground state energy, which is k. So, if we consider k as the unit, so answer becomes 2.25, that is 9/4. Now, let us see the last question here. The orbital angular momentum quantum number. The orbital angular momentum quantum number, what they are asking us here is L. Okay. Now, what do we know here? To know L, we already know that it has one radial node, S2. We are talking about S2. We know that it has one radial node, R equals to 1. We need to find L, but for that we need to know the value of N. How do we calculate the value of N? Simply, now, for hydrogen plus atom, we know that E is equals to K. For Li2 plus, this E is equals to 9k by, that is 3 square. This is z square is 9k by n square, right? Now, for S2, they tell us that the energy is equals to how much? Ground state of hydrogen, which is k. So, this whole thing is equals to k. So, we can divide the k and get the value of n as 3. Now, when we have the value of n as 3, we can write that radial node is equals to n minus l minus 1, that is 1 is equals to 3 minus l. This we have to find out here, 3 minus L minus 1, correct? So, 1 is equals to 2 minus L. So, L becomes 2 minus 1 equals to 1. So, how many angular momentum quantum number, what is the value of L? This is the value of L. Alright, with this, we will finish our today's class, and I'll see you soon with another topic, same time tomorrow. Bye bye, take care. Happy learning.